Hi, this is Joe Bonamassa, and all weekend I'll be playing some of my favorite blues artists and also personally introducing you to tracks from my new album, Redemption. There's more soon, right here, in B.B. King's Blues. It's Joe Bonamassa. I've got a song for you now from my new album, Redemption, here on Bluesville. Deep in the blues again. Oddly enough, there's always a song on each of my solo albums that I have no intentions of playing live, no intentions of ever listening to, or ever addressing again after the fact that we record them. This would be one of those songs. Unfortunately, it's one of the favorite songs of not only the record company, but everybody around me. I don't know why. It's one of those songs that I kind of wrote and was like, I don't think we're ever going to get to this. It was a bit of a throwaway in some sense of the word, not to demean the co-writer that I wrote it with, and we've written some great songs together. It was just one of those songs that we both kind of agreed it wasn't the greatest song we've ever written, but it was, again, one of those songs that you have to write in order to get a great song out of something else. And unfortunately, it's gotten one of the best responses of the record. Just because you can don't mean you should. That's a saying that I've had for a long time. You know, there's a lot of creativity in the world. Some of it good, some of it bad. And there's just because of the internet, you can go down these rabbit holes and see people's ideas and especially, I'm a car guy, I'm a car fan, car collector, and you see people putting pictures of, Mount Rushmore on their Ford F-150 or something like that, or doing something crazy with an automobile, or doing something crazy in life and driving down the freeway, with no doors or something like that. It's just crazy stuff. You see it every day online, and you see it every day in life. And I came up with this saying called, just because you can doesn't mean you should. You know, it's just one of those things. Like, I could cover Led Zeppelin's Stairway to Heaven. I can. Doesn't mean I should. And that's the idea behind the song. It's just, and we did like a Gary Moore treatment on it. And live, for some reason, well, I know why, because it's just I have an opportunity at the end of the song to overplay as much as I possibly can. Live, this has been the superstar. Of all the songs we've been playing off the record. So that's that song. And just remember, next time you hear an ill-advised cover song or see somebody doing something stupid on the street, think of that song and go, just because you can, don't mean you should. I've got a song for you now from my new album, Redemption, here on Bluesville. Love is a Gamble. Here's a song that I wrote with Gary Nicholson. And Gary and I have written a bunch of songs over the years. And he was really instrumental in kind of getting me into this frame of mind going, let's just recreate a Freddie King song, and do it the same tempo and do it the same way. I'm like, cool, let's try. And that was Love is a Gamble. And we just kind of cut it live. I still think it's a little fast, but that's just me being hypercritical of the record. And it's one of those songs I think, let's cut it again at the right tempo. And everybody likes it at that tempo. So, you're kind of seeing, ladies and gentlemen, how little control you have over your own destiny in all of this as a solo artist, because everybody has an opinion that chimes in. And, if you listen to yourself and the voices in your head that you name, chances are you'll never put out a record because you're always riddled with this self-doubt. So you have to listen to other people and make the best of it. Redemption on Bluesville. Molly O, this song, I've kind of been doing these series of songs about boats and people on boats, especially old boats like the Titanic. Like, I wrote a song for a band I'm in called Black Country Communion, and it was a song about the violin player who played everybody off on the Titanic. And this one here is about a passenger on the same boat. And, you know, it's all about the story. It's a sub story. You know, everybody knows the story of the Titanic. Everybody knows the story of these great ships that kind of sailed and sank. And, you know, what the thing about this song was, it's just a story of a woman who happened to be on these ships and is forgotten, you know, because they were handwritten manifests, handwritten, you know, ledgers. And, you know, it's the backstory of a passenger on one of these great sailing vessels of 100 years ago. And one of the things that got me about this song is we never shy away from the Led Zeppelin influence. I never do, at least, especially on the solo albums. And this one is no exception. So we kind of really dive deep into that mid-70s era Led Zeppelin on this one. We get a little prog as well. And it's a fun song to sing. It's a fun song to play live. It's a big epic, you know, and then it's always important to throw something simple at them after. It's a bit of a sorbet. King B Shakedown. There's no hiding the fact that I'm a huge Freddie King fan. And Freddie, among the three kings, Albert and BB as well, here on BB King's Bluesville, here on Sirius XM, Channel 74. Freddie is probably the most unsung hero of the three. Never really had the big smash hit song back in the day, but his catalog was just wonderful. And he always did a great boogie. You know, you go and see those live cuts of him playing. He always did a great boogie. He did a great version of Going Down, the Don Nix tune that we covered on a record. And so this is kind of my tribute to Freddie King doing a boogie. And it really comes off well. And it's an open A. I don't think Freddie ever kind of played around with open tuning. So it's a little bit different. And there's a little bit of a slide solo on it as well, which is always fun. But King B Shakedown here on Sirius XM 74. Stronger Now in Broken Places. This is a song that we did twice. We did once as a full band, and it didn't really have the sensitivity that it needed. And I remember being in Las Vegas, and we were finishing up part of the album, and Kevin goes, why don't you play this on the acoustic guitar or the nylon string guitar? And I said, you know what, Kevin Shirley, I'm referring to our producer who's produced everything I've done for the last 15 years. I said, no problem. And we did it. And it really had this really awesome, intimate feel that kind of bookended the record. And it's just one of those things that I really feel the sentiment of the song was much better on the acoustic guitar than it was with a full band on the electric guitar. And normally I'm completely the opposite of that mentality, because I really do enjoy electronic music, not drum and bass, but plugging an electric guitar into an amp and playing loud. I really do enjoy that. And sometimes acoustic guitars I kind of regard as kryptonite. But this is the one odd occasion where it works out in reverse. It's kind of like this mystical southern thing. You know, it's like there's all these characters floating around Nashville. Now I have a place in Nashville now, and you know, there's always these mythical southern religious themes that kind of permeate into the music, into the life, into the culture. A lot of it's religion and geographical location, you know. It's the locusts that come, or the cicadas that come every summer that create these eerie sounds emanating from the forest. And the ghost of Macon Jones is kind of a tribute to that. And one of the great thrills of my recording life is being able to sing and work with a guy named Jamie Johnson, when I first heard his record called The Guitar Song, I was in the audience at David Letterman and Anton Figg, my longtime drummer and longtime David Letterman drummer, almost 30 years, got me tickets to go see Letterman. You know, I figure they won't book me on the show. I'll go watch it. And Jamie was the musical guest, and he came out and he sang this song. It was so authentic. And I was like, wow, this is like instant classic country music. And this was about 10 years ago. And I remember buying the record and being an instant fan. So the fact that he was able to come in and sing the song with me was just a thrill of a lifetime. I really think Jamie is in that league with the Hank Williams and the great songwriters, singers, country artists of all time. I think he's going to go down as one of the all-time greats. He's just that authentic. He is that guy, you know, and that you can't fake. You know, there's other channels on this radio station, but there's a lot of, let's say, fake cowboys out there, but Jamie is the real deal. I've got a song for you now from my new album, Redemption, here on Bluesville. Pick up the pizzas. I secretly wish that I was Tom Waits in another life, you know? There's nobody cooler than that. There's nobody who writes lyrics like that. And nobody sounds like that, you know? He has that smoker's voice and just can paint a picture with a poem. And does this always did these beautiful ramshackle bluesy type of songs. And Pick Up the Pieces was kind of a tribute to him. Lyrically, I'm not in his caliber at all. But it was just an idea that I had going, you know, I screwed this thing up again. I'm going to pick up the pieces and I'm going to exit stage right, you know, and that's the whole idea about Pick Up the Pieces. It's the sorbet, as they would say, after a song like Self-Inflicted Wounds. Self-Inflicted Wounds is the real look at oneself in the big terms of, you know, the redemption and trying to make yourself a better human. Pick Up the Pieces is when you have to laugh about it because there's nothing else you can do. Evil Mama. This song I wrote with a guy who has been doing the Buddy Guy records, among others. His name is Tom Hambridge. He's a wonderful writer, producer. And we've been writing songs together for about 5 or 6 years, and we got introduced by Reese Winans, and we wrote this song kind of, you know, in tribute to Tower of Power, and we wanted kind of a funky up-tempo instrumental, something that be fun to solo over, but also something you can sing on, and we've been playing this song live, and it just goes over great. And it's just a groove I've never really, you know, Funky and Joe Bonamassa have never gone together historically. So this is my first attempt. I hope you enjoy it. Redemption. This is a song that I wrote with Richard Page and Dion and James Howe. So it's kind of a big collaboration. And it's the title song. And it was the last song we did for the record. We kind of needed to, we had this redemption theme, but we didn't have a song called Redemption. And, you know, to work with Dion is just an absolute honor. And Richard Page and James Howe as always. You know, but Dion, he was one of the founding fathers of rock and roll. He was at the Surf Ballroom with Buddy Holly. And, you know, and Richie Valens and the Big Bop. And he still has this youthful enthusiasm about music and about writing. And he has a world-class singing voice. He's a world-class musician. And I hope when I'm like 75 years old that I have that still you wake up in the morning and go, I'm excited about playing guitar. I'm excited about making music. And Dion is that guy. And I'm very honored to work with him. Also, with, you know, obviously with Richard Page and James Howe on this. But Dion came up with the chorus. And he was like, yeah, here's your chorus, son. You know? And it was just great. Hi, this is Joe Bonamassa. And all weekend, I'll be playing some of my favorite blues artists and also personally introducing you to tracks from my new album, Redemption. There's more soon, right here, in B.B. King's Blues. Hello, this is Joe Bonamassa, and it's time for another of my favorite blues players in B.B. King Bluesville. Albert King was the soul singer who begrudgingly became a blues legend. He wanted to be Rufus Thomas. He wanted to be Carla Thomas. He even name checks him in a song called I Love Lucy. You know, he was a Stax recording artist. And, you know, the thing about Albert's stuff was he had this velvety voice for a big guy. You would think he'd be like this blues shouter, almost like Freddie or BB or Howlin' Wolf. But he had this like wonderfully velvet singing voice. And he played a flying V guitar upside down where the high strings were on top and the low strings were on the bottom. And he got this wonderful sound out of it. And he only knew about 6 or 7 different phrases, but he used them to devastating effect. And his songs, it's the thing about Albert's stuff was the songs. You know, I'll play the blues for you, you know, Born Under the Bad Sign. These are staples. And that's the one thing I always took from Albert King was the fact that he had great songs. And without great songs, you can be the greatest guitar player and the greatest singer in the world. Nobody's going to notice you. Clapton. People always ask me, Joe, who's your favorite singer, songwriter, and guitar player? And I always go, Eric Clapton. Again, it's songs, it's playing, it's his singing. You know, to me, he personifies what I always want to be as a musician, because not only is he a journeyman, he's a blues man, but he also, you know, wasn't afraid of a pop song. And he wasn't afraid of a melody. You know, he kind of towed the line between, I'm just a straight blues guy. And then he was a pop star. And then he makes a record like From the Cradle, which is like one of my favorite, you know, blues albums of all time. And in the height of his pop stardom. And you just go, there's the kind of artist you want to be. You know, just that internal barometer of what's good and, you know, and never following trends. And if you see yourself becoming a trend, change it and do something else. Howlin' Wolf, when you take the Sun Records tour in Memphis, if you're down there and you take the Sun Records tour, one of the things that sticks out to you is when they do the whole thing about Sam Phillips. And, you know, you would think his favorite artist would be Elvis Presley or, you know, Johnny Cash or somebody like that. Sam Phillips came out and said that my favorite artist I ever recorded was Howlin' Wolf. And I can see why, because there was nobody better at delivering a haunting blues vocal and a poem set to blues music than Howlin' Wolf. He was the gentle giant, and he was the gentle giant who, when singing songs like Evil and Spoonful, it scares you. You know, it's so guttural. But then you listen to him speak, you know, and he's like this giant, humble man, but had these internal demons that just would come out of him every once in a while. And his catalog, it's just one of the things that just blows me away about how good blues music can be and how authentic it can be. Hello, this is Joe Bonamassa, and it's time for another of my favorite blues players in B.B. King Bluesville, Muddy Waters. Talk about a songbook. Talk about a voice. You know, I always say Muddy Waters invented electricity. I stole that from that movie Crossroads, when Willie Brown goes, Muddy Waters invented electricity. Electric blues would not be the same without Muddy Waters. Songs would not be the same without Muddy Waters. There would be no Rolling Stones without Muddy Waters. That's how important a blues artist he is. You know, he's one of those things where when you listen to the lyrics, it's poetry. And it's beautiful poetry written by a guy who grew up in a cabin in Mississippi, but wrote some of the greatest poetry in the 20th century, in my opinion, and could really sing, and he really could play the slide guitar, and he really could write. And that's just Muddy Waters in a nutshell. Robert Cray. Someone that, in my opinion, does not get enough attention and accolade. I grew up listening to Robert Cray. I love his records. And when MTV used to play music videos, it actually did play music videos. M stood for music, not, you know, variety shows and you know, people doing stupid things and reality stars. It actually stood for music. Robert Cray had some video hits, Strong Persuader, Right Next Door. And that's when that was my introduction to Robert Cray. And I remember seeing him live in 1987 with the Midnight Horns. He was just on fire. And one of the great blues voices you'll ever hear, one of the great guitar players you'll ever hear. And to me, when you talk about a great guitar player, can you identify him in two notes? And when you listen to B.B. King and Eric Clapton and Ry Cooder and Robert Cray, you can identify him in just two notes. And when he sings, it's like just this ultimate package. And, you know, he's one of those artists, if you see him come through your town, I mean, you have to go see him because it's a wonderful concert and a wonderful display of musicianship from the whole band. Rory Gallagher, the Irish hero, one of my favorites of all time. And again, the thing about Rory's music, kind of like with B.B. King and Freddie King, it was all about the live. He would leave everything on stage. And, you know, I remember picking up an album called Irish Tour 74, and there was another live record called Rory Gallagher Live. And he just had a flannel shirt on and a beat up Fender Stratocaster. I remember putting it on because he kind of looked like my father at the time. My dad was working in a factory. And I was like, wow, this is like really speaks to me because it's a working class music sung by a working class guy. And I grew up in upstate New York where all we had was factories in winter and gray skies. And in Ireland, they had factories and rain and gray skies. And it kind of... really, there was some parallels, you know, geographically in the music that was coming out of Ireland. So, you know, Rory is a blues man, always, you know, really hit me to my core because of his, you know, that blue collar, you know, working class hero type of music he made.
Mama's in the kitchen picking up a pie. Daddy's in the backyard. Get a job, son. You know you're hard to try.
One of my favorite people and guitar players and singers in the world, Walter Trout, who has had his fair share of health problems in the last 3 or 4 years, but has come out the other side a happier, healthier human being and still plays the guitar like nobody else. And I always say this, and I've said this to Walter, is if it wasn't for guys like Gary Moore and Walter Trout paving the way, I wouldn't exist as an artist because Walter and Gary proved, especially in Europe, that there's a market for a fiery electric rock guitar player to play blues. And that's what I kind of consider myself, is a fiery electric guitar player that's more rock based than blues, but really loves the blues, you know? And somebody like Walter Trout, he's had this great career, played with John Mayall and toured Europe more times than most people can say their name. It really ultimately is the archetype for artists like me and the young generation. It has really inspired the young generation to be, you know, that kind of player. And he has a song and or an album or something. It's called Too Loud, Too Many Notes. And I just love that title because he, among a lot of guitar players of our ilk, have been told that more times than we can count.